Very good morning to all the panelists and the participants. I welcome you all to the third day of 5 days faculty development program. Before we start today's sessions, I will provide succinct of yesterday's technical session. Yesterday, three experts shared their experiences and expertise. Our first expert, Dr. Mrityunjay Mahapatra, Director General of Meteorology, India Meteorological Department, Government of India, explained in detail about cyclone monitoring and warning. He talked about the hazard due to cyclone, genesis of cyclone, location, intensity, pressure drop, estimated central pressure, pressure of OCI location, depth of convection, early warning system, cyclone warning organization, analysis, prediction, warning, cyclone warning dissemination. Dr. Mahapatra highlighted that the information provided by IMD is useful for general public to know about the weather forecast. It is vital for fishermen, civil aviation activities, and farmers. IMD has high power radars and uses satellite system also. IMD, through its various activities, certainly plays a significant role in creating awareness about the importance of climate and weather in life and economy of India. IMD also certainly played a vital role in India's progress. He also underlined that hazard risk mitigation is a key to sustainable development, and this has been policy of Government of India, which lays greater emphasis on prevention, preparation, and mitigation. Keeping this in view, Government of India run a pilot project, National Cyclone Risk Mitigation Project, being implemented through World Bank assistance to reduce the impact of cyclone. IMD is the nodal agency forecasting cyclone in our country. IMD has considerably increased its efforts in recent years in the areas of tropical cyclone forecasting and verification. Our second expert of yesterday's session, David Alexander, is professor of Risk and Disaster Reduction Institute for Risk and Disaster Reduction at University College of London. He underlined the need to balance vulnerability and resilience. Resilience is indeed a multifaceted and refers to the ability of individuals, societies, or socioeconomic systems to cope with sudden impact of crisis or disasters, and to restore as quickly as possible their ability to function and their capacity to act. He also talked about cascading disaster risk and highlighted the need to come up with innovative solutions to manage this cascading disaster risk, such as investing in complex risk scenario planning supported by systematic risk assessment for multi-hazards, promote disaster risk reduction measures as a public good, build financial resilience through scaling risk financing, insurance, and risk transfer for natural hazards and pandemics. He also highlighted to build a regional social innovations ecosystem that links the multi-sectoral approaches for disaster risk reduction together. Our third and last speaker of yesterday's technical session was Professor Chandan Ghosh from IIT Jammu. He shared various innovation and technologies to enhance our resilience to various disasters. He highlighted that enhanced resilience allows better anticipation of disaster and better planning to reduce disaster losses rather than waiting for an event to occur and paying for it afterwards. Increasing disaster resilience is an imperative that requires the collective will of nation and its community. Although disasters will continue to occur, actions that move the nation from reactive approach to disaster to a proactive stance where communities actively engage in enhancing resilience will reduce many of the broad societal and economic burdens that disasters can cause. So this was the summary of today, yesterday's technical session. Now I hand over the mic to my colleague, Dr. Harjeet Kaur, who will be the moderator of today's sessions. Over to you, Dr. Harjeet.
Thank you very much, sir. I once again welcome everyone to the third day organized by National Institute of Disaster Management in collaboration with 12 central and state universities and on the onset, I would request Professor Vinod Kumar Jain, Vice Chancellor, Tejpur University, former professor of Jawaharlal Nehru University, for his keynote address. Professor Jain served as a scientist, class 1, from 1983 to 85 in the Department of Physics, India Institute of Technology, New Delhi, before beginning his journey as an academician. Now the floor is yours, sir. Over to you, sir. Professor Vinod Kumar Jain.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Kaur. I thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to be sharing my thoughts. Although by any stretch of imagination, I am not a disaster risk reduction expert, but since I have been practicing the discipline of environmental sciences for quite some time. So I do have some thoughts of my own. And what I'm going to talk now also has some inputs from my own disaster management cell within the Tejpur University. Disasters, as you all know, are a regular feature on our planet, and doesn't matter what the nature is, whether they are geological or hydrometeorological or biological, and the kind of disaster we are facing these days, this biological disaster which has engulfed the entire planet. So the world is not it's not that it is not familiar with the disasters. They have been happening in the past, and the previous century was also witness to numerous disasters in different parts of the world. This century also, as the climate scientists have predicted, that the severity as well as the frequency of the extreme weather events is perhaps going to lead to many disasters. So all the nations, the entire world community has to be prepared to meet these challenges of this 21st century. Having said that, most of the governments have put in place the disaster risk reduction mechanisms or framework in their sustainable development agendas or in their developmental planning. And the reason so obvious that since the disasters do cause huge damage to life and property, and that has a huge economic cost. So the economy of the countries, and especially those which are not so well developed and so poorer countries, they find the disaster burden in a sense very, very huge, and can be very unsettling for the economy of these countries. So no wonder that the disaster risk reduction framework has been now introduced in the planning of most of the countries, and India is also one of the frontline countries in this respect. A brief look into the history of this disaster risk reduction. Way back in 1960s, actually, for the first time, some social scientists, anthropologists, and development workers started thinking for some alternative approaches to manage disaster by correlating disaster events with differential vulnerability factors of hazard-prone areas. So the early 60s, In fact, they were the times when actually people started thinking about these disasters and what are the vulnerable societies or vulnerable sections of the societies which are affected by disasters. And it's around that time also that the issues of resource consumption and the environmental degradation came to the fore. And I don't want to get into the entire series of events leading to the 1992 World Summit, the Sustainable Development Agenda. And that's when, you know, the disasters also found the mention, and then subsequent protocols and agreements and the world summits, deliberated on the issues of climate change, sustainable development, you know, how to arrest the damages due to the disasters. And I think some of you who are in this domain of disaster risk management, you would agree with me that a lot of international effort has gone into strategizing how to cope with the disasters. And in fact, the decade of 1990s, was declared by UN General Assembly as International Decade for Natural Disaster Reduction. And that just shows how the UN, that is the world community, was serious about doing something about the disaster reduction. Then, of course, some of you may be knowing about this Hyogo framework and then Sendai framework. Indian government enacted its Disaster Management Act, as you know, in 2005. And later on, we have this policy, National Policy on Disaster Management in 2000. And as you know, the main objective of this policy was to develop holistic, proactive, technology-driven, and multi-disaster-oriented strategy to address all aspects of disaster management, covering prevention, mitigation, preparedness, response, and recovery phases, institutional, legal, and financial arrangements, techno-legal regime, capacity development, knowledge management, research and development. But if you look at the essence of this policy, the DRR, the disaster risk reduction is central to it, is the essence of this national policy. This is all about building capacities of the people, of the community, of our society, our government, and the country as a whole. But then the question which is begging the nation is that how do you build a sustainable society, a resilient society? And I'm sure some of the speakers before me last 2 days must have touched upon these dimensions. But the main aspects of disaster risk reduction framework or mechanism would be, to my mind, and I think I'm sure some of you already are aware of this, pre-disaster reduction planning. That is so crucial in order to, you know, tackle the impacts of disaster. And as most of you who are faculty, teaching the disaster management courses, you must have touched upon this pre-disaster reduction planning, which involves prevention, mitigation, preparedness, and risk assessment. And that followed by post-disaster risk reduction planning. So both are equally important, but the first one is perhaps more important. And therefore, in the pre-disaster reduction planning, the identification and assessment of the risk is very important. And it is in this context that the locale-specific geographical features, environmental parameters, the socio-economic data, which would be helpful in assessing the vulnerability aspects of the population. So all that is very important. And I think then sort of look at the essence of this disaster risk reduction framework or mechanism is to understand A, the hazard, B, the exposure, and then the C, the vulnerability of the people and the assets. So I think it is in this context that the coming together of all the stakeholders, whether it is the government, the policymakers, the institutions, and I'm very glad that NIDM has taken this lead in forging a collaborative platform of Indian universities and institutions for this disaster reduction network. And this is where I believe that the universities especially have a great role to play. The UGC has taken this lead in issuing advisories to all the central universities and state universities, and including the private universities. In fact, in the entire higher education sector, they have issued an the advisory that the disaster management courses should be made compulsory. But one of the things which is perhaps also required is that there were some suggestions earlier that there should be a UGC NET exam. I'm saying this in the context of the university. This UGC NET exam should also incorporate disaster management as a separate subject. There are some 89 or 90 odd subjects in which the UGC conducts the NET. And since the number of people appearing for the UGC NET exam is quite huge, and I think so, I think therefore that all these students who are aspiring to join the academic world, they would be sensitized just by preparing for this UGC NET exam in the domain of disaster management. So I think it is important that the UGC also approves the introduction of this disaster risk reduction as one of the subjects. In addition, this would also help if there are several online courses or MOOC courses. I think the faculty can take a lead in developing these MOOC courses, which could be offered through online mode. Now, so what is it that we should be doing if we want a sustainable society or a very resilient society? Some of the steps one could take is that we could do location and element specific risk analysis to understand hazard and vulnerability profiles of different localities. You see, India is such a diverse country. And in case of India, as some of you know, that more than, 50%, in fact, close to 60% of our landmass is vulnerable to, earthquakes, for example. Some more than quarter of our land area is susceptible to droughts, and then some 15 to 20% or something like that, I may stand corrected, is prone to floods. So in case of India, I think it is important that the location specific risk analysis is done to understand the hazard as well as the vulnerability of our country. Then the formulation of land use regulation considering local risk factors. Unfortunately, in our country, as most of you would endorse, that the unplanned urbanization, this unsustainable expansion of the growth, or this expansion and growth around the major cities and urban areas, where many a times some of these land use regulations are violated, or first they are violated and then they are regularized. You know, these things do eventually hamper the disaster risk reduction measures. Then adoption of suitable structural and non-structural measures to make all physical resources resilient to impending hazards. Another thing, another step is the environment-friendly development and use of green technology to reduce negative impacts of development on environmental capital or environmental resources. Judicious use of natural resources to prevent over-exploitation these resources so that they can be preserved for future generations. Likewise, we have to have energy efficient means to fulfill the needs of our growing population. Then very important aspect is the hazard specific early warning mechanism. And in fact, some of the thrust area programs of our country, in fact, even of DST, are related, and I'm sure of that Ministry of Earth Sciences, are related to this hazard-specific early warning systems or early warning mechanisms. And this is where the role of the universities also becomes very important. I think most of the universities these days, I mean, you know, they have some kind of GIS facility, remote sensing facility, they have high computational servers available in most of the good universities. And so therefore, the modelers, the mathematical modelers or climate science modelers, the environmental science people, you know, who will have some people specializing in mathematical modeling of atmospheric processes or extreme weather events, they can be entrusted with the responsibility of doing the impact analysis, developing various scenarios. For example, if in a particular flood-prone area, if the precipitation exceeds a certain threshold, then what will be the impact on the area in terms of, you know, the total area which is inundated, for example. Likewise, how many people will have to be evacuated or relocated, or so this impact analysis by the universities will go a long way in preparing the pre-disaster reduction plan. And then, of course, you have the legal institutional framework for disaster risk reduction planning and proper implementation of the plan. I think our country is one of the leading countries which has taken the lead in this regard. The education and awareness of vulnerable communities about disaster risk and risk mitigation measures. This is something where the engagement of the universities with the local communities or with the vulnerable communities which are likely to be impacted by the events of disasters. I think that's where the universities can play a very important role. In fact, if you recall that under Unnat Bharat Abhiyan, all the universities have been asked to adopt some villages. And this is where, the awareness programs can be taken up by the university faculty and the students on a regular basis, and come up with do's and don'ts in the form of the booklets or the material which spreads the awareness about any likely disaster which may impact them in future. I would like to conclude by saying that there is no one size fit all kind of prescription in the case of disaster risk reduction. It has to be locale specific, it has to be region specific, it has to be population specific, depending on the socioeconomic conditions of the people. I would like to sort of here mention in this regard the very important work which ISRO has been doing, or some of these organizations which are connected or part of ISRO's network. They are doing a lot of good work as far as the disaster risk reduction plans are concerned. And as some of you may be knowing, ISRO have this Bhuvan portal, and then they have this, they have this data repository thing, and so people can share and upload and get access to the data of a specific region. But here again, the universities can play again a very important role in providing the ground truthing, because the universities are blessed with the human resource in terms of young students who in their field expeditions can undertake this ground truthing, the generating the data on a micro scale in those regions which are disaster prone areas. So that could be complementary to the efforts of the government bodies like ISRO or Indian Meteorological Department or our own NIDM and Disaster Management Authority. And as I said in the beginning, I think our country is one of the leading countries as far as this seriousness about adopting disaster risk reduction measures are concerned. And I think we must appreciate the efforts of the government in this regard, because very often, you know, in the past, the governments have relied on relief-centric disaster measures rather than the pre-planning based measures. But increasingly, the government's focus is rightly shifting into the pre-planning of the disaster risk reduction. So overall, I think as far as I feel personally, although as I said in the beginning, I'm not an expert in the disaster risk reduction, the field of disaster risk reduction, but I must say that I think the cooperation of all stakeholders is so crucial in order to meet the challenges posed by the anticipated disasters which are likely to face us or be before us in this century. So the coming together of all these stakeholders, including the universities, institutions, public, and everyone, is so crucial. So with these words, I really appreciate the efforts of NIDM and all those who are involved in organizing this FDP for the faculty of the universities. So thank you so much. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
I would request Professor H.S. Yadav, Director of Northeast Regional Institute of Science and Technology, for his special address. Sir, over to you.
Good morning, madam. I take this privilege to submit our respect on my own behalf and on behalf of my institute to all the learned vice chancellors and experts, and particularly NIDM and Major General Manoj Kumar Bindalji, who is executive director, and his team to enable us to share our feelings. It has been a tremendous task for NIDM to bring together all the academic leaders throughout the country, and I really appreciate. Professor Jain Saab has already given historical aspect, and I believe that the previous speakers during 2 days must have delivered several aspects. So, not taking much time, I would like to briefly express my view. In fact, none of the disaster incidents can be stopped from taking place, but the impact can be minimized by proper preparedness and effective response during the operations. This can be achieved by taking wide range of logistics in the disaster relief operation, which can help to manage effectively natural disaster in the preparedness and response stage at the state, district level, and even at the rural level, particularly in Arunachal Pradesh. Quite often we have the landslide, and we have a flood, sometimes huge loss of life. So ultimately, opting to preparedness and disaster risk reduction can lead ultimately to save millions of lives and cost in terms of infrastructure, property, and assets. As natural disaster incidents are occurring frequently in our states, there has been urgent and essential need for a framework to manage the logistics operations effectively and efficiently during any disaster relief operation. And we must focus while framing the policies at national and state level, particularly to ensure that the preparedness and the other considered awareness goes down to the common people as well. Disaster risk is an indicator of poor development, so reducing disaster risk requires integrating DPR, DRR policy, and DRM practice into sustainable development goals. Since we cannot reduce the severity of natural hazards, the main opportunity for reducing risk lies in reducing vulnerability and exposure. And we need to manage risk not just as disaster, but the part of sustainable development must be induced, which involve each and every part of society, government, non-government organizations, and professional and private sector. Therefore, it is required that it should be people-centered and multi-sector approach, building resilience and cascading and intricating hazards, and creating a culture of prevention and resilience. So consequently, disaster risk management must be focused and designed in a way to avoid the construction of new risks, address pre-existing risks, share and spread risk to prevent disaster losses being absorbed by other development outcomes and creating additional poverty. Although disaster risk management includes disaster preparedness and response activities, it is expected to perform much more than managing disaster. So I am really very happy that we are proud to have National Institute of Disaster Management under Ministry of Home Affairs. And I must mention that during February 27 to 29, this year only, national level training program on disaster management was sponsored by NIDM. Dr. Suri Prakash Ji and Sri Anil Kathayat, a scientist from NIDM, they visited the remote place of our location, Arunachal Pradesh, where we organized this training program. And Professor Suri Prakash Ji delivered a very comprehensive informations concerning concepts of HVCR and landslide hazard vulnerability and risk management. Dr. Sri Anil Kathayat Ji talked about disaster management initiatives and action in India. We had other experts, Engineer Arun Siram, who delivered role of telecom in disaster management. And very notably, we had Commandant Sri UK Thapliyal Saab, who was looking after at that time in Arunachal Pradesh Center. He delivered on role of disaster management and risk operation. And he successfully demonstrated all tools available at his center in Arunachal Pradesh, which is quite often being used to save the life of during the disaster. And Sri Professor R.K. Prasad Saab talked about tools to national disaster prevention, preparedness, and mitigation. And he introduced Vulnerability Atlas of India. And Dr. Swapna Acharji delivered on role of remote sensing and GIS in disaster management. So I'm very happy to make a note of it. And the role played by National Institute of Disaster Management to help the country in this domain has been outstanding. And we are expecting that the new policies, including the suggestions made by our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Jayan Saab, he mentioned that disaster management should be included in the NET examination. And similarly, although at the institutional level at NERIST, we do cover some part of awareness about disaster reduction risk and the management issues under our NSS and other some ED programs with our graduates and undergraduates. But then it has to be percolated down to the school level as well in some form, particularly the highlighted part of the need of preparedness and suitable response by the common people. And it can be only effective if it starts from the school. Not taking much time, I understand that there is limitation of time for the organizers. I appreciate by heart the comprehensive effort made by NIDM, and we are happy and proud of having such institution which is working for the nation, and its knowledge is being disseminated not only to prevent the disaster risk in the country, but the knowledge is also percolating down globally. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Now I request my colleague, Mr. Raju Thapa, to facilitate the inaugural session.
Am I audible? Understand, am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible, Raju.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Harjit Kaur, first of all. Professor Vinod Kumar Jain, Vice Chancellor, Tezpur University, rightly mentioned that in India, the concept of disaster management has evolved from a reactive approach to gradually multidimensional, proactive, holistic approach. And Professor H.S. Yadav, Director NIRIST, also underlined that The disaster risk reduction education is very crucial for all the communities living in the disaster prone area. It's a huge task to be achieved in a very short period system. Sir rightly pointed out that this is only possible when we build a partnership with different stakeholders and synergize our efforts. Universities and institutes, including private universities like Professor Vinod Kumar Jain has mentioned, can play a very major role in shifting the narrative for disaster risk reduction for the future by its education, research, debate, dialogue, and policy and advocacy. We are very grateful to Professor Vinod Kumar Jain, Chancellor, Tejpur University, and Professor H.S. Yadav, Director of Northeastern Regional Institute of Science and Technology, for accepting our invitation and sparing their precious time to share their wisdom with us. And I must also mention our deep appreciation for our distinguished speaker of the day, Sri P.P. Srivastavaji, RTS retired member, NDMA Advisory Board, Major General Dr. V.K. Nayak, recipient of Kirti Chakra and Ati Vishesh Seva Medal, Senior Consultant, National Disaster Management Authority, Sri Randeep Kumar Ranaji, he's the Deputy Inspector General from National Disaster Response Force, Government of India, who will share their vast knowledge and experience with us. Without taking much time, and I would also like to express my gratitude to our Major General Manoj Kumar Bindal for providing this innovative and encouraging environment and for moral guidance and helping us in all our future endeavors. I hope today's session will be very beneficial for all the participants and they will have some key takeaway points from this lecture. Over to you, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ajit Thapa. With that, we have come to end of our inaugural session. Now moving on the session, we have senior level resource person experts who have very long and meaningful experience with vast knowledge on the subject. During the technical session, there will be a presentation, and after each presentation, there will be a question answer session. Please raise your question in Q&A window only, as your active participation is very important to us. One more important announcement, that participants having 80% and above attendance in Cisco WebEx event in all the 5 days of the training program shall be eligible for program certificates. The same link will be used for all the 5 days of the training program. The National Disaster Response Force is an Indian specialized force response to a threatening disaster situation or a disaster under the Disaster Management Act 2005. For our first presentation, we have with us Shri R.K. Rana, Deputy Inspector General from National Disaster Response Force. He will be sharing with us the role of NDRF during a disaster. I'll request Shri R.K. Rana, DIG NDRF, to deliver his talk. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Harjit. And good morning, all the participants. And my special good morning to Mr. P.P. Srivastava. It is always such a pleasure to be in his company, and I'm sure the audience will be much more enriched and enlightened by his presence and comments. So starting with my presentation, it's a small presentation about NDRF. At the same time, I'll be touching about the response mechanism existing in the country, though from the syllabus, these topics have been covered elsewhere also, but I'll be running through it so that if any one of you have any addition or question on that part, I would be happy to engage in that as well. So to begin with, I'll start sharing the presentation, and if some of you are not able to see the presentation, kindly raise hand or mention it in the comments box. To begin with, when you talk about the disasters, we usually confuse them about the natural happenings. Like if there is extreme rainfall, that is not a disaster in itself. But the floods caused by it result in a disaster-like situation. Similarly, all other natural happenings, they have been happening since the time immemorial. And right from the formation of the earth, which in itself was again a result of catastrophic natural disaster. Similarly, in past, though our ancestors, they have been very wise in dealing with all these natural happenings, how to minimize the loss from these natural happenings has been learning since times immemorial. But still, there have been occasions when a last majority of population has been wiped out because of one happening, disaster-like happening or the other. Not only in our part of the subcontinent, but elsewhere in the world as well. Disaster definition per se, all of you must be aware, it is any event, whether it is natural or man-made or of any quantum, which cause damage or loss either to the property or human lives. And basically there are various formats for this definition, but the basic format is any happening, whether man-made or natural, which affects the normal course of human life and results in the damage and loss of lives. Classification of disasters, it is again the difference between natural disaster and man-made disaster. This line is very, very thin. Where a natural disaster affects the human lives and the property because of the roles of humans, whether to keep it in the category of natural disaster or human induced disaster, it is anybody's guess. But for governance purpose, people always prefer to keep all these disasters in natural disaster, because that gives an safe passage from the fixing of accountabilities. Natural disasters, as you can see on the screen, you all must be aware, these are the normal natural happenings. And I put this sketch specifically for this purpose only. It's a rainfall, and water has to channelize itself. And when we humans usually habitate in the normal water channels, we are in a way causing the rainfall to become a disaster-like situation. So this was the thin line I was talking about few minutes ago. Though it is a natural happening, but it has been converted into a disaster-like situation because of our own human planning deficiencies. Similarly, man-made disasters, though the natural disasters, sometimes the damaging potential is increased multifold because of human deficiencies. But at the same time, some disasters can be categorically classified as induced by human involvement. And be it industrial disaster or industrial disaster, it can be sort of in the form of chemical fallouts, in the form of biological, it can be in the form of even radiological repercussions. And as you all must be aware, entire cities, entire zones, they have become inhabitable because of such man-made disasters. Chernobyl is now a part of history, but even after many decades, that complete city, it's such a beautifully designed city. And if you see the available videos of Chernobyl, present day Chernobyl on internet, you'll find how nature is rejuvenating itself in the concrete city. Similarly, in our country also, since past industrialization is taking place, very rapid growth is there in the industrial framework. So, almost every month, there are 4 to 5 cases of chemical accidents. Many of them are minor in nature, do not come to limelight, because they are handled at the local level within the capacity of the plant itself. But almost 15 to 16 incidents per year happen in which there is loss of life because of this chemical leakage. When we talk about disaster vulnerability of our country, ours is a large country with different geographical spheres, and you think of any disaster, our country is vulnerable to that. One part of the country is vulnerable to drought, another parts of the country they are vulnerable to floods. So varied type of disasters, they keep happening in our country, and the vulnerability is very high. This is a common data basically, but many a times this data is also misleading in the forms proneness or vulnerability in itself is not a threat or damaging factor. How we address that vulnerability, how well we prepare ourselves to face that vulnerability, mainly depends on the quantum of loss. When we talk on the world scenario, India is one of the highest vulnerable disaster prone countries in the world. And from this figure, you can see the US is on the top when you talk about the economic loss suffered due to one disaster or the other. And the difference is very, very huge between, you'll find the major difference between the developed countries and developing countries. That is not because of the frequency of disasters or the veracity of the disasters or the actual damage caused, but because mainly the reconstruction cost, the cost which is you can say either in compensation distribution or economic factors, since the that is much higher in countries like US and West. So that's why in economic terms, these countries are much ahead of our subcontinent. But when we talk about the number of incidents and the number of human deaths, our subcontinent is topping the world. Last 20 years has been we have had many disasters which had taken a great toll, not only in terms of loss of human lives, but great damage to the property and livelihoods. Because of the recurrent happenings of various disasters, and especially in the last decade of 90s, starting with the Odisha super cyclone, we had five major disaster like situations causing death of almost 35,000 plus people. That ended up enactment of Disaster Management Act and lot many things, including the NIDM, where we are attending this course today, NDRF, which I am representing today, NDMA, SDMAs in the states, SDRFs in the states. A lot of change has come after enactment of DM Act in 2005. Basically, disaster is, if you talk about the response part, it starts with the community and basically ends with the community. Rest all others, including police, fire services, civil defense, other volunteers, SDRF, NDRF, armed forces, we all are in assistance to the community. And community in a way is the not only the victim but also the first responder in most of the such disaster like situations. We have almost similar kind of response mechanism at the national level, at the state level, at the district level, and the similar mechanism is expected to downflow from the district to the lowest PRI level, that is the smallest habitable unit level, be it a village or a cluster of villages. Similarly, forecasting agencies, we have forecasting agencies for all the natural happenings, and our country is we have done a excellent work. If you talk about the forecast, IMD and other agencies, they are doing a wonderful work in forecasting, be it rainfall, be it cyclone, be it other happenings. And if we say that we are a pioneer in the world in this field as of today, it can be easily said. Many countries in the world, they look up to India about the forecast about various happenings. And especially the cyclone forecast, last one decade we have had six very damaging potential cyclones, and IMD's forecast has been almost correct to the extent of timing of landfall, the route, the damaging potential. There have been occasions where other agencies of different countries or different organizations outside the country had different forecasts, but at the end of it, the forecast by IMD proved to be accurate, and that's why the other countries in the world also, they agree on this, that the India forecasting system has come off its ace. And we are still ways ahead in our region, that is the other countries in our part of the world. And our forecasting agencies, they are helping in the form of information on the forecast to our neighboring countries as well. These are basically the alerts, the color codes, because it becomes simple for the government to understand. Red is the symbol of warning since ages, so that's why the color codes have been given accordingly, so that all the people who have something to do with the forecast, they understand the significance of the forecast by simply looking at the color codes itself. NDRF also is a fallout of DM Act, and in the DM Act itself, it was envisaged that we as a country should have a specialized disaster response force, and that's the basis of formation of NDRF. To begin with, the central paramilitary forces, that is BSF, CRPF, CISF and ITBP, they all had raised two each of disaster management battalions, and it formed the main crux of NDRF when NDRF in this present form came up in 2009. All these eight battalions, they were merged to form NDRF response force, and thereafter two more battalions were added to NDRF strength in 2010. Another two more battalions were added in 2015. So as of now, NDRF is 12 operational battalions strong. In 2018, four more battalions were sanctioned. Out of these, one battalion from Assam Rifles has already joined NDRF and it is undergoing training and will be operationalized in a month or two. Rest three battalions, they are in the process of raising, and by end of 21, NDRF will be 16 battalions strong. All the personnel in NDRF, they come on deputation from various central paramilitary forces for a specified tenure, and after induction in NDRF, they go in for a induction training, which is a specialized training for a disaster response, and after their tenure is over, they go back to their respective parent organizations. Basically, NDRF, it is a disaster response force, but disasters do not happen all the time. So at the time of disaster, disaster response is the obvious role of NDRF, but when there is no disaster like situation, then we are training our men, training other stakeholders, training the state disaster response forces, training other paramilitary force personnel who have a secondary role in disaster response, conducting various community awareness programs, school safety programs, mock exercises, mock drills, etc., so that the capacity of the country as a whole is enhanced. So, as I told earlier, there are 12 operational battalions. Each battalion has got 18 teams, and all these teams, they are multi-skilled in the sense that they respond to aquatic disasters also, they respond to collapse structures also, they respond to severe and emergencies as well. So all the teams, they are equally trained and equipped to respond to any foreseeable disaster like situation in the country. Apart from 12 battalion headquarters, where we have the major chunk of our response force available, we have 28 regional response centers also spread throughout the country depending on the vulnerability, and there the strength is either one team or two team or three teams depending on the requirement. Apart from regional response centers and battalion headquarters, we have around 11 tactical locations also where strength of NDRF is kept on permanent basis. As of now, NDRF has footprint in 51 places across the country where our troops are available round the clock, all the year round, for any response within the area. Since detection, especially be it the aquatic disasters or collapse structures, or CBRN, detection is a basic requirement. So NDRF has got the technical apparatus for detection and search, as well as we have got canine squads also, which are very effective in searching the live people buried under debris. Since time is of essence in disaster response, at each of these 50 locations, minimum one team remains on alert. On alert means that is almost on wheels, the equipment loaded in vehicles, and the minimum response time is 30 minutes. But usually the team leaves the campus within a time of 10 to 15 minutes. These are basically the disasters NDRF people are trained and equipped. And usually fire is not the mandate of NDRF, and NDRF do not have capability to respond to fire incidents. And basically fire, sometimes it end up in collapsed structures also. In such a situation, NDRF usually tries to pre-position its teams in the nearby vicinity. In case of any such eventuality, our teams respond to that situation as well. To match the needs of response of various facets of the disaster, NDRF teams are equipped with the specialized equipment. That is, as per the requirement felt within the country and what other response forces across the world, what they are having. So according to that, the kit of NDRF equipment has been notified, and NDRF has got state-of-art world-class equipment as of today, and efforts are made to augment this holding of equipment as per the availability of newer and newer kind of equipment. Since there is a NDRF is a human force of central government of India, and there is a certain protocol for requisitioning assistance of NDRF. But since, as I told earlier, time is of very, very crucial, the NDRF teams, if there is any information available, be it some government officials of any where in the ladder, or even from a member of community, if there is information about some major incident, our teams start the response mechanism. And in the meantime, if the information has come from other than the, say, district authorities or the state authorities, by the time team prepares itself, parallelly efforts are made to get in touch with the DM or other concerned officers at the state to gather more information. And usually NDRF teams, they move in such situations without any formal requisition, which usually takes their own time to come. And all our battalion commanders, they have been delegated this power. They can deploy their teams without any approval from NDRF headquarters or any other agency. And parallelly, they can send this information and seek approval. But no response mechanism waits for any formal approval. Major operational activities of NDRF, usually we are just at the end of monsoon season. Monsoon season is one of the most hectic deployment periods for NDRF. And as part of monsoon season, usually the allied disasters like building collapse, etc. Like we have one incident going on of building collapse in Mumbai, Thane, as of today, in which more than 60 people were buried, 20 people they have been taken out live, and unfortunately 37 people could not be saved. Another 6 to 7 people are still missing, and the operation is still going on. Basically, all these are the operational phases which I think most of you must be aware through the media. And by putting them here is basically with a intention just to spread this awareness. This in case of any such disaster, then if information is available with any one of you, then it can be passed on to NDRF, and NDRF will not lose any time to respond to the situation. This was another peculiar incident in which an entire train was surrounded by flood water, and flood water was rising very rapidly. It was raining, so Air Force choppers also would not be pressed into service, and all the routes to the place where the train was stationed were also submerged. It was a very risky operation, and by the time NDRF reached at the site, water had already started entering the compartments, but fortunately all the passengers were safely evacuated from the train. Chennai again in 2015, it was a very unique case of urban flooding, and a large part of the city was underwater, and a lot of people, they were either they had to be evacuated, or they had to be provided immediate relief in the form of essential commodities, food, water, etc. at their houses. And it was one of the biggest operations in the entire world when we talk of urban flooding. Similarly, flooding in Kashmir Valley in 2014. This is also unique in the sense this was for the first time in the entire known history of last 40-50 years in the entire world, when the entire capital city of a state was underwater. NDRF also responded in overseas operations. That was the first time in 2011 in Japan, post tsunami. There were multiplicity of disasters generated by the effects of tsunami were there, effects of earthquake were there, and because of shaking, it ended up in the nuclear leakage as well. NDRF team one team of NDRF responded in that disaster. This was a small incident in which one vehicle was it accidentally fell into a river, and since distance wise NDRF was in proximity, it was NDRF nearest team was around 200 kilometers from there. India was requested by Bhutan, and NDRF team was pressed into service. Nepal earthquake is one of the biggest earthquake which our part of the subcontinent has been affected with, and NDRF team responded very swiftly in this incident as well, mainly because of the quick decisions taken by the government, and NDRF teams were in Kathmandu in 5.5 hours after the earthquake had occurred. This is one of the swiftest international assistance movement in the world, and the UN also appreciated this action of India in assisting our neighboring country. Training, as I told earlier, is very important part of our everyday affair, and we usually train our people in to face and respond to all the foreseeable disasters in the country. Since medical assistance is a very, very important part in any response post disaster, to each of our team, they have qualified medics, as well as all our rescuers. They are very well trained in medical first response. Since within the country, the only experience we have is from the actual response, so to enrich that further, NDRF has been training with some outside agencies also to have an exposure what all other agencies in the world are doing in this field, and so that we can also take a cue from that and prepare our teams accordingly. We are engaging in a big way with the community also, and that is in the forms of various training programs, various awareness programs, various institutionalized mechanisms in conducting the safety drills, and almost on any given day, NDRF is conducting more than a dozen such drills in one part of the country or the other. Since disasters do not know boundaries, whether within the country, state boundaries, or the international boundaries, so cooperation within the region is also a very, very important part of disaster management. And NDRF, as a response force of the country, has been engaging in various platforms with our counterparts in the neighboring countries, in the form of various learning exercises. This is a exercise which was conducted for SAARC nations in Delhi NCR region. This was in Malaysia. Apart from exercises, we have been providing training to some of our neighboring countries' responders. This was another exercise which we coordinated for the BIMSTEC countries. This was for SCO member countries last year. This was for BIMSTEC countries again, because it is supposed to be an annual exercise. So second exercise was also held in India in Feb this year. And the basic aim of these kind of exercises is to learn from each other. We also get to know what the neighboring countries or the countries taking part in the exercise, what they are doing in terms of holding of DM equipment, various procedures they are following, and at the same time to let them know what we are doing in India in this field, so that at a time of assistance, we can help each other. Communication is very, very crucial at the time of disaster, though otherwise also it is very important. But when someone is in crisis, it is even more important. And in any major happening, communication is usually the first casualty. So therefore, NDRF has got multi-layered communication setups, including the satellite terminals, so that in case of conventional communication fails, the radio communication works, and to augment that, we have satellite terminals. NDRR is a National Disaster Response Reserve. It is a kitty of certain disaster response items, which is held at various NDRF locations. And the purpose is, in case of requirement, because procurement process takes a long time, and the people in distress, they need assistance immediately. So certain kitty is always kept ready, so that in times of need, these relief items can be immediately rushed to the affected people. Basically, post Mahalakshmi train evacuation last year, that prompted the KBC team also to invite NDRF for a say on a show on KBC last year. So these were the brief from my side, and since time is short, so I'm open to any questions or queries from your side, if there are any.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. NDRF has proved its importance in achieving this vision by highly skilled rescue and relief operation, regular and intensive training and retraining familiarization exercises within the area of responsibility of respective NDRF battalions, carrying out mock drills and joint exercises with the various stakeholders. Thank you very much, sir, for sharing your vast experience and knowledge with our participants. Sir, there is one question for you. As education sector has a big strength of youth, how can education faster response activity?
Yeah, definitely education sector has a major role to play in this. And I'll put it in say two phases. One is, like any other part of the society, the educational institutes are equally vulnerable. Like if we talk about the Nepal earthquake, it happened at around 11:45 in the day. Fortunately, it was a school holiday. Had the schools been open, the number of casualties would have been, I think, 5 to 6 times more. So therefore, each educational institute, whether it is a school or a technical institute or a center of higher learning, all the institutes should have a DM plan of their own to help themselves, help the various human components present there. At the same time, since ours is a country where people are short of information and knowledge, and the centers of learning, they can be the biggest sources of awareness generation. If we in schools or colleges or other educational institutes, universities especially, where we have one of the brilliant and the active minds of the country, if they are aware about various facets of the disaster management, about various safety drills, they can be the best resource people in their neighborhood. So apart from making DM plans and rehearse those DM plans for the institutes themselves, the human resource available in the institutes, be it the faculty, be it the students, be it the other members of the education community. They can act as the awareness generators of the country. And if we take it as a campaign, because in schools we are doing it in a big way, and we are also doing it in some other educational institutes, in universities as well, in colleges as well, but their frequency is less because of the more emphasis on the education related activities. And from our experience in our school safety programs, the general feedback is they are the best teachers in their homes. They are the best teachers in their neighborhood. In case of earthquake, many of our people, even the people who are engaged in actual disaster management, they are part of disaster management ecosystem in the country. Still, there's a lot of confusion. What should we do if an earthquake has happened? There's a lot of confusion in that. And we found that our school children, they have been great messenger carriers in this field. They have been telling, if you are living in a multi-story, please don't rush out. You will be the you'll be harming yourself. And we usually tend to gather this feedback from the schools, from the students. And on the basis of that, I can say our education community, it has a lead role to play. And if they are actively involved in this information gathering and then dissemination of it in the other members of the community, that will go a long way in making our community disaster resilient. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Now moving ahead for next presentation, we have with us Major General Dr. V.K. Nayak, Kirti Chakra Ati Vasish Seva Medal recipient, who is currently the National Disaster Management Authority, Government of India, New Delhi, as a senior consultant, and is involved in planning, coordination and conduct of various capacity building initiatives at national and international level. The floor is yours, sir.
Good morning, everybody, and it's a great pleasure talking to be amongst the top education persons of the country, and very privileged to share my thoughts with the gathering of so many professors and teachers who are indeed doing a great service to the nation as it is, and the contribution in knowledge awareness, knowledge spreading for disaster management is already acknowledged and already brought out by the Vice Chancellor, Tejpur University, Dr. Jain. A lot is happening and a lot can happen. So it's a great privilege to be among the people who are involved in the in the domain of education in the country. So my brief is basically to talk to you about the disaster response and capacity building in the sense of how mock drills and mock exercises are conducted all over the country. My job has been facilitated partly by DIE Rana, who has told you the macro picture. My intention will be to tell you how the response at the national level, at the state level, at the state level actually unfolds on the ground, and what goes on to bringing NDRF, armed forces, the whole government machinery, like you saw in case of Nepal, you saw in case of Kerala floods, the visuals seen by you, how it happens on ground. So I'll just take a minute to open this. I hope my presentation is now seen on the screen.
Yes, sir, your presentation is visible.
Okay. So I'll be basically focusing on institutional mechanism for response in particular. And as you all know, disaster management contains a whole of activities, and response is one part of disaster management. So basically, I'll be focusing upon how response is done from top to bottom, from the national level right up to the panchayat level in the country, what goes into it and what needs to be done and how the coordination unfolds and certain salient aspects at the end of it, where does our teacher community fits into it, partly already covered by DIE Rana. So this is well known definition of disaster, no more deliberation on this, but it is definitely beyond the coping capacity of the locals. That is why you need from somebody from outside to come and help. And this is a process, planning, organizing and coordinating response, evacuation, rescue, relief, not only these, but also preventing, mitigating, capacity building. So as I told you, disaster management is includes several activities and response is only one part of it, and which is the response manifests best on based upon what our preparedness has been. And after every response, we enhance our preparedness. So coming on to the institutional mechanism, the background and history covered by Professor Jain also and the previous speakers also, but this single DM Act passed by the Parliament 2005 covers complete mechanism which you see on ground today, may it be NDRF, NDMA, SDMA, the National Crisis Management Committee. The Act covers everything and it's become binding on us now to attend to the disaster management, or else as per Act, many people in the chain of governance are answerable for things not going the way they should go in case of any aspects of disaster management. So as already told to you, besides this Act, we have a national policy on disaster management enunciated in 2009, which gives the broad guidelines. And we also have a national disaster management plan of 2016, and latest edition is of 2019, in which a total methodology of how disasters are going to manage in this country, keeping in view our commitment to sustainable development goals, our commitment to Paris COP, our commitment to the Sendai framework, how we're going to manage disasters, how we're going to reduce the risk, and who in the country, at the national level, central government, various ministries, at the state level, state government and various ministries, at the district level, exactly who is supposed to do what, not only for response, but for all the parts of management, like disaster risk reduction, disaster mitigation, preparedness, structural mitigation, non-structural mitigation, relief rehabilitation after disasters, everything is laid down. So I thought I'll just bring to notice, this is available on the NDMA website and many other places, a very, very comprehensive document in which all the tasks are listed, including capacity building, where universities will come into play, where UGC is responsible, everything is listed there. And coming on to important structures, a slide was shown to you. We have NDMA, NIDM, State Disaster Management Authority, District Disaster Management Authorities as per the Act. At the apex level, you have a Cabinet Committee of Security, National Crisis Management Committee, National Executive Committee and State Executive Committee. These are the institutions, these are the organizations which are controlling and planning and steering the disaster response in particular. I'll talk about response thereafter, in particular in the country, helped by NDRF, SDRF, Armed Forces, you have CAPF, there is Central Paramilitary Forces, Civil Defense, Fire Services, Home Guards, Youth Organization includes the CNDU and NCC, National Service Scheme in Universities and Colleges. And why I said senior division cadets of NCC, because of the hazards involved in disaster response, the policy allows only senior division cadets to be involved, boys as well as girls. And at the end of it, you see this bullet of community as first responder. The one of the pillars of our national disaster management policy is that first responder has to be community. And we have to take steps to see that disaster response is managed at local level first with the local resources and locally trained people. That is the most desirable thing today. And our policies and plans and directions are aimed towards this. More of it a bit later. Coming to the role of governments now, primary responsibility of disaster management is with the state governments. And central government supplements and efforts of state government. Being a federal structure, every state government has to prepare itself based upon its own hazards, own risks, own vulnerabilities, and duly analyze it and make their plans and create resources within the state to not only to respond to these disasters, but also to effect overall disaster risk reduction in the sense of the national plan. And state government, the central government comes with all the help at the behest of the federal resources, whatever we have, it's available to the whole nation, and you see it happening day in and day out. You saw so many visuals of NDRF being present in service. As a matter of fact, on humanitarian grounds, the NDRF, all the armed forces of the country, and the central parliamentary forces, if they get a call for disaster response, they will be responded immediately without awaiting orders from any other higher organization, and they will be information addresses, and lateral information will be sent upwards and downwards, but action will start on ground. And that is a very good thing which is happening in the country today. And a lot of procedural obstructions, the barriers today stand eliminated. Besides, we have financial mechanism, we have something called State Disaster Response Fund, National Disaster Response Fund. Now latest is we have created National Mitigation Fund also, and that exists, that money exists, is available for disaster response, for increasing of preparedness also. Besides this, there are nodal ministries for disaster response for specific disasters. I'll show you a slide a bit later on. Like Ministry of Civil Aviation is for air accidents, Railway Board, rail accidents, Department of Atomic Energy for nuclear disasters, and so on. And this National Crisis Management Committee is there in every ministry. You see every ministry is doing some, has a major role to play in developmental activities and providing certain services to the country. And disasters will affect these activities like the Ministry of Agriculture. They are supposed to ensure the food security of India. In case of a biological disaster, in case of some crop disease, they have to come into action and see what's been done long term and short term. So they have, all ministries will have their crisis management group to include the Ministry of Home Affairs, to include the Department of Atomic Energy. They have these crisis management groups. Today something, there's an alert on nuclear industry, the crisis management group of the Department of Atomic Energy will get into action immediately and attend to it along with the Ministry of Home Affairs. This mechanism already exists. Besides, we have to have a National Emergency Operations Center at central government at MHA, and similar chain of state emergency operation centers and district emergency operation centers are required to operate down to district level. So this is the basically the slide telling you who in the country at the apex level, which ministry, which department is responsible for which kind of disaster. The pandemic of the recent pandemic, ongoing pandemic, you see all the actions taken by Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. Just to tell you, when it started in month of December, January, we must say that this was out of proportion to our preparedness. But as we got grip of the situation, the response came on various fronts, which included imports and export of certain necessities, which included stopping of exports or even things like masks and ventilators, which included encouragement to industries to create things which are required to find in the pandemic. research and development is already going on. We have so many institutes working with the foreign universities and foreign institutes for development of vaccine. So disaster response, disaster preparedness, structural mitigation, non-structural mitigation, community awareness, everything in this case of pandemic is going side by side, because this is a long drawn thing. We don't know where it's going to end. But this is the best classic example how from top to bottom, state governments are a federal, are supposed to manage it within states. So every state, West Bengal, Maharashtra, Haryana, they're doing it based upon their requirements and their necessities. And central government helping wherever required. Same thing happens in case of floods. Same thing happens in case of earthquake. So this is how we are organized at the apex level. And this is the mechanism at the national level. You see, we have top level decision making bodies, Cabinet Committee on Security, the National Crisis Management Committee. And I've already spoken about the disaster designated ministries. We have NDMA. Then there's something called National Executive Committee. I'll come show a slide bit later. And then you see state government and union territories linked to the National Crisis Management Committee and the National Executive Committee linked to the Armed Forces, Central Armed Forces, and NDRF. Similar analogous structure is there at the state government also, at the state level also, which is, this slide is quite self-explanatory, but you see in the second line, your State Executive Committee, and then the Relief Commissioner of Nodal Department, Relief Commissioner of State, he is controlling the complete disaster management apparatus of the state. And disaster management responsibilities within the districts, we'll elaborate it a bit later on. So this is the broad structure. Now, I told you about cabinet apex level institutions. This Cabinet Committee on Security, as you know, the Prime Minister, Defense Minister, Finance Minister, and Home Affairs, and Minister of External Affairs. But where does it fit into? The disaster management. If any disaster has got national security perspective, then this national, and this Cabinet Committee on Security comes into play. This includes the CBRN disasters, like, just for information, not too long back when Fukushima disaster happened, the whole thing was studied, and based upon the observations of what went wrong in Fukushima disaster, nuclear disaster, it was a natural disaster linked with a nuclear disaster, tsunami caused this. So it was studied, and the Cabinet Committee of Security then issued certain orders and instructions based upon it. A lot of actions being taken in our nuclear industry to plug the gaps, to be better prepared for disasters which has happened elsewhere in the world. Then we have this National Crisis Management Committee. Now this committee gets into action immediately when something very drastic happens in the country. This is for crisis as well also for a disaster. Just this is a matter of semantics. Every crisis may turn into a disaster. Every crisis is not a disaster, but for the terms of governance in a country, a big law and order problem can be a crisis. A hijacking problem can be a crisis. So, and also a developing situation in Bihar or UP, where rivers are in spate and after 2 days, we are going to get huge floods. It is also a crisis. So National Crisis Management Committee gets together, and very rightly, it consists of the Cabinet Secretary and all important secretaries of the Government of India, and they are basically oversee the command, control, and coordination of disaster response operations. They give directions to crisis management groups of ministries where required, like in case of nuclear industry or in case of aviation accident, if NCMC is sitting, they will be working through the crisis management groups of Ministry of Aviation or Department of Atomic Energy. Now, NDMA is basically, it's an authority which basically into policy plans and guidelines and coordinating the response, coordinating the enforcement of policy and plans. The NDMA essentially is not the responding agency. Response is done by NDRF, SDRF, state governments, the crisis management groups of various ministries, and NDMA basically approves the plans which are made by the national plan, made by National Executive Committee. The state plan is made by the State Executive Committee, and the NDMA and SDMA approve these plans and suggest modifications, improvements, if any. And that is why you see the Prime Minister is the chairperson and there are 9 members. So this is a very, very high level body which basically oversees all policy planning and guiding of disaster management activities in the country. Now, I spoke of National Executive Committee, whereas the National Crisis Management Committee was being headed by the Cabinet Secretary. This committee has been headed by the Union Home Secretary, and there are 14 ministries. Every important ministry which is required for disaster response is included, and secretaries are included. So, moment a National Executive Committee sits, all ministries get into action with by their senior-most secretaries being present with the Union Home Secretary to attend to the problem. You also see the Chief of IDS, the Chief of Defence Staff, is also ex officio member. The whole might of the nation, the armed force of the nation, is also available along with this National Executive Committee. So moment a National Executive Committee is making a response plan, is taking action, the Chief of Defence Staff is aware of what is required, and parallel orders flow. Army, Navy, Air Force, Coast Guard, everyone gets in no time orders and instructions of what is needed to be done. Similarly, Union Home Secretary himself is the chairperson. NDRF and armed forces do get into action on their own. Any structured thing, any structured instructions, any additions, any deletions are done by Union Home Secretary along with this committee. This was touched upon by DIG Rana, and only thing I want to add is we have offices of IMD in many parts of the country, and same goes for Central Water Commission. So the local coordination also is done, and at local level the states and districts get lateral information apart from it being coming from top in a centralized manner. This is just to explain to you the operational setup for disaster response. You see, when there is a warning, then the suppose there some disaster will come with warning, some without warning, earthquake no warning, floods cyclones warning. So when warning comes, the MHA, the National Disaster Management Division, gets into action. The National Crisis Management is informed. The MHA control room informs the state control rooms, and state control rooms inform the district emergency operation centers. And then at national level as well as state level, you see the state crisis management group and the under the chairmanship of chief secretary getting activated. And on the right hand side you see the IDS ops room. This is the operational room of integrated defense staff, and this works 24/7, and they guide all the response by armed forces, made by Army, Navy, Air Force. And similarly, at the affected site, the yellow rectangle which you see, the operations start. Relief and rescue operations, establishment of communication network, drinking water, power supply, whatever disaster response functions are there for saving lives and restoring normalcy, start on ground. This is normally the operation structure setup. A bit of it about in little detail we will cover, time permitting. So now I shall talk of response per se, how it unfolds and how it should happen. Now you will agree with me that we are very, very transparent these days. The social media is there, the print media, electronic media. We as responsible people, we are being watched, we are being seen. So any response activity has to be a quality response activity, and it has to be comprehensive, effective, swift, and well planned. NDRF team, when it reaches a site, it reaches there for comprehensive response. It has got everything which is required for saving life and property once they are on ground. But another group of people, suppose they reach there without equipment, without training, it's not comprehensive response. It has to be swift and it has to be well planned. So there has to be a mechanism for this. Why I'm talking of need for a response mechanism is that all of us in whatever domain you are working, starting from the senior most government official, starting from the people who are not in government, say the academy of the country, people in private sector, all of us will rise to occasion for a situation and we'll do our best. We'll do everything possible humanly, and whatever knowledge we have, whatever equipment we have, whatever resource we have, we will do everything to save life and property and help ourselves and help the community. But all this is ad hoc. So we need to have a proper system under which you save maximum lives and make sure that minimum damage to property is there. So what are the shortcomings of a response system? Normally, when we respond, I've just listed around quickly, have a look at it. Lack of accountability because of ad hoc arrangements. There's no planning process. Beforehand plan. You have to response plan on ground. Then you can respond to a particular situation. Yes. Once your plan is inadequate, you can build upon that plan, but you can't start making a plan in face of a disaster, in face of a crisis. The unclear chain of command, lack of proper communication, inefficient use of communication systems, there are no predetermined methods and systems. Who will do what? If NDRF team comes on ground, who in the district will send them to area A or area B or area C, where the disaster is equally struck? Who will decide where a column from army will go and where a column from NDRF will go? Who will decide if the only two helicopters are available, what task they will do first? Whether they will do reconnaissance and communication for seeing the overall situation, or they will start casualty evacuation immediately. So it all depends on how plans are made. So someone has to coordinate all these things. So these shortcomings are overcome if you respond as per a system. And this is nothing but incident response system. We in the country have adopted a incident response system ourselves, which is nothing but a system for minimizing loss of life and property by strengthening and standardizing. You see the strengthening and standardizing the response mechanism. What is it all about? This is the National Disaster Management Guidelines on Incident Response System. This NDMA has advised all the state governments to adopt this system. This is about 200-page document which tells us how incidents are supposed to be responded to. And since time is a premium and we are talking to a very, very enlightened body of audience today, so this document is available on the net, and when you see it, you will realize that if this system is followed, we will be economizing, we will be more efficient than going in an ad hoc manner. Just to get a glimpse of it, all response has to be as per this response system. A lot of state governments have notified that response to disaster happening as per this incident response system propagated and recommended by central government and NDMA. So what is it? So before we see how the response should be efficient, just focus on what all needs to happen in response. There are certain emergency support functions which will have to happen. Saving of life, casualty evacuation, provision of water, shelter, medicine, psychosocial care, and whole of activities will take place in incident response. You take your mind back to the ongoing pandemic, you take your mind back to Cyclone Amphan, you take your mind back to any disasters which were shown to you by DIG Rana. These are the kind of actions which will have to happen in response. So early warning, maps, satellites and ports will have to come. People, animal will have to be evacuated. Search and rescue will have to be done. Medical care, food, communication, housing, and temporary shelters will have to be made. Power, fuel, transportation. Calcutta, power went off. In many, a lot of urban areas, power goes off during disasters. Relief logistics, supply chain management has to start. Animal carcasses have to be disposed of. Host of activities, and if any one of these activities is not happening on ground, we are not efficient. Recently, we had a aircraft accident, and in southern India, we had an accident in Mangalore a couple of years back, and people had to run from pillar to post to look for the dead ones. We're not well organized, and the bodies were charred. So all this could be controlled. The stress of near and dear ones, the stress on administration could be mitigated if there was an emergency control room, if there was information, incoming information, outgoing information of one source. All this has to happen under the incident response system. And you see, media is also involved into this some work. As per the DM Act and as per the incident response system, there is a responsible officer, and at the, since the DM, disaster management, is a responsibility of the state government, the chief secretary in the state is a responsible officer. And the district magistrate in the state is a responsible officer for disaster response. And you see the next bullet under it, incident commander. Now, chief secretary of, say, UP may nominate a secretary of urban development or a secretary of relief as incident commander for looking after all aspects of flood relief in the state. It can, and this incident commander, and you see certain rectangles below, we have operation section, planning section, logistics section. And to help the incident commander, we have information and media officer, safety officer, liaison officer, the deputy. So this whole structure which you see just below the bullet of responsible officer, just under the chief secretary or just under the district magistrate, the whole structure is nothing but the incident response team. And this incident response team is common for all disasters, which have already been foreseen and planned. At district level, the beauty is that this mechanism works at state level, it will work at district level, it will work at subdivision level, tehsil level, even it will work at the panchayat level if you wish to, even it will work at this your college, university level also if required. In case of chemical industry, in case of big corporates, everywhere it is applicable, it is universally applicable. And I just like to focus, for any response, you have an operation, some operations have to be planned, some planning has to be done, and some logistic has to be ensured. So there are a group of officials club for planning, group of officials club for logistics, and group of officials club for operations. When something goes wrong, I'll show you a couple of visuals. The whole emergency incident response team has to get together in district or in state, and they'll start planning. They'll plan based upon what? They must know what has happened. They must know what do they have. So based upon the resources at their hand of man, material and equipment, based upon what has gone wrong where, based upon the geographical dispositions, based upon the priorities to respond. There may be earthquake where in some locality reports are coming that there are many casualties, and some reports, locality reports are coming that there are lesser casualties. So priorities have to be decided, because all this response is happening at a local level to begin with. The NDRF is yet to come. The SDRF is SDRF may be there, may not be there. Armed forces are yet to come. But immediately on something happening, this mechanism has to go in place. Based upon this, operations are done on ground by some operation commander. State level, it could be DG police. District level, superintendent police. Logistics section, the district supply officer may be looking after all logistics, food, water, everything will be there. So this is how the system functions. This is what is I've been trying to explain to you. The incident responsible officer state at the chief secretary, commander, incident commander, he will handle the response, operations, direct and supervise all tactical actions on ground, planning, all input data. When we talk, I told you about emergency operation center, district level, state level. What needs to be done, we must have state of art emergency operation centers. These emergency operation centers will get direct feed from ISRO, from IMD, from NCOIS. All technical data should come, all local data should come, and they should be duly linked with the communication. And that is how that becomes a hub for it's a kind of command decision support system, helps the chief secretary, helps the district magistrate to take decisions and deploy forces for efficient employment for disaster response. Last one is important. In the IRS system, we have this logistic and finance also incorporated. So side by side, the finances are being looked into. If a district magistrate cannot spend more than 5 crores in one go, his finance people are involved. They tell them what to do to get emergency, what action to take, and how the whole thing has to be done. So there are no audits later on. So whatever emergency response has to be done on ground, you see operations section, planning section, and logistics section, and activities written under it. So willy-nilly, all these activities have to be done on ground, but who will do what within the IRS system is written down here. Operation section, search, rescue, law and order, evacuation, planning will do assessment and response, and logistics will provide all wherewithal for people on ground. This is what happens in war for armed forces also. Now, with this little background, I think I have about 1 o'clock. Yeah. I have about 10 minutes more I'll take. Now, I told you about the IRS. So, to ensure that this incident response system is understood on ground, the National Disaster Management Authority has been undertaking national level mock exercises, district level mock exercises, where we involve the complete administration, the NGOs, and the community also to respond in an efficient manner. And just give you a glimpse of that, this exercise on the ground, we are basically seeing that our preparedness is evaluated. We see whether our plans and standing operating procedures are adequate or not, and if not, by virtue of doing a mock exercise, our gaps are identified. And those gaps are filled by doing it, by revamping the plans. So the NDMA undertakes these exercises in consultation with state governments, and we do it in 4 parts. Basically, first we do coordination, then we do a tabletop exercise, which is basically a dry exercise without deploying resources on ground. And in Army, we call it sandbox discussions. Here we have all officials available. I'll tell you about it, how we conduct it. And then we do a mock exercise on ground where resources are deployed on ground. And we do a follow-up and evaluation procedure. I must see time. Who takes part in this? So at the state level, you see the whole hierarchy, incident response team. These are people who will be part of the incident response team at state level in any case. At the end, you see this telecom service providers, the border road organizations, anybody and everybody who is responsible has to take part in the exercise. We ensure that Secretary Health, Secretary Revenue, Secretary Industries, representatives from Public Works Department, they are all available because they are the responders at state level. At district level, these are the officials who we make sure that they take part. And how it happens on ground, I'll tell you in a couple of slides next. As I told you, mock drills and mock exercises are enhancing our preparedness. By virtue of NDMA doing this mock exercise on ground, we are enhancing the preparedness, ongoing preparedness of states and districts in the country. Because of our proactive approach, the moment we do this exercise, we ask for updated DM plans, we ask for status of EOCs, we ask for resource inventories. So willy-nilly, you will agree with me, a district magistrate or even state administration, they're so busy in the routine activities that they are overwhelmed. A district magistrate hardly any time to attend to anything which occupies most of his time. So virtue of the exercises, we brush up the preparedness, coordination with the Army, NDRF, awareness campaigns that go on, and preparatory work is done. So we coordinate the conference, then tabletop exercise. I told you how it happens. We test the district, the DM plans of districts. We ask them to present the plans, and we discuss those plans. It's not only plan given by district magistrate. We want a plan from chief medical officer of the district. How many hospitals? How many beds? What does he do for surge capacity? We want the plan from the chief engineer of the district, of the state, of chief engineer from the district. How will he restore a bridge which has gone? How will he restore roads which have gone? How power will be restored? How electricity, how water supply will be restored? These are the kind of questions we asked, and we asked them for their plans, and then situations are painted at district level and at line department levels. We tell them roads are cut off, what will you do? We tell them mobiles are not working, what will you do? We tell them hospital is overwhelmed, what will you do? We tell them hospital has got casualties to be taken off, but road is not there, what will you do? You need a helipad next to the hospital. You need to man carry the casualties. So all this, their minds are energized, and basic aim is to tell them where are the gaps. And we also tell the districts to bring out their own criticalities. I mean, when we talk about response at local level, we are saying that local administration, local community, the best people. They know what can go wrong rather than anybody else from outside knows. So we play up all that, and this is how we run the tabletop exercises. Similarly, mock exercises when you do on ground, we decide a sequence of events. We decide scenarios beforehand. Okay, tomorrow at 10 o'clock, we'll sound siren in five districts of UP. In five districts of, say, Uttarakhand, and we'll play up an earthquake, and then we'll see what happens. And we put observers to see the reactions at various levels. Then mock exercises are commencing at a particular message given by us. Experts on NDM are available there. Emergency operation centers will be activated. And we see how the apparatus of incident response with whatever available unfolds on ground. What does the hierarchy do to get help from outside? District from state, state from central government. What do they do? What do they do to get the technical assistance? How do they get touch with ISRO? How they get touch with IMD? What is the interface? So I'll just conclude by showing you a couple of slides and going over the steps of mock exercise. But this is the actual steps of response also, which will happen on ground, for which whole of number of stakeholders are involved. The moment something goes wrong, the incident response team has to come to emergency operation center. Now, a lot of them will not reach because of the earthquake or because of cyclone, but they have to get in touch and they have to organize themselves. So emergency operation center meeting will take place at district level or at state level. The planning will start. You see logistics section, this is an exercise in Uttarakhand. The logistics section is getting inputs and planning. And based on this planning, all assets and personal report to nominated area. Now, if there's already a plan, you've told that army column will reach in case of a warning, in case of earthquake, so and so place will come. Your NDRF will come to so and so place. So they all come to a staging area, and some staging area commander takes stock of what resources are now available. And this is dynamic. People will keep coming, keep getting deployed. And then damage assessment carried out by the incident response team at the planning section, and they come to know from visual, they come to know from inputs from ground what has gone wrong. They do the damage assessment, and then teams are sent on ground. Casual, this is basically for a chemical disaster, the visuals, and teams go on ground. When the whole operation is, the whole picture emerges, then operational commands are briefed, the resources are located, incident action plan is made, task forces. A group of people to go to particular area, a group of people go to different area, one medical team, five ambulances, one bulldozer, 20 volunteers and 100 laborers to go to so-and-so housing society if a house has collapsed. NDRF team has come, they have been directed there by somebody else. So operations commence on ground. When on ground, they establish a command post like this, because here also there is a, this is a dynamic situation. Initially there were 5 casualties, now there are 10, 15, 20, one more aftershock has come, one more house has collapsed. So we must have communication from command post to the emergency operation center in the district or in the state, and search and rescue ops will commence on ground. Medical aid post is made next to the areas. Casualties are removed to medical aid post. Triage is carried out. Prioritization. Casualty evacuation will have to be done. Why triage is carried out? Casualty evacuation not first come first. So otherwise, in a site, you see two ambulances coming and they'll take first two persons who are bleeding. They may not necessarily be the most serious persons, and they may not necessarily most serious casualty. So triage is done on the spot and they are evacuated based on priorities. Now this is how the surge capacity will have to take place in hospitals. For this, again I said, plan within plans. The district disaster management plan, there has to be a district medical plan in which there has to be a hospital disaster management plan in which the business continuity of hospitals be ensured plus surge capacity has to be ensured. This surge capacity is done. Then evacuation is planned if required. See the buses lined up. Now somebody has sent these buses here, and this all is happening for emergency operation center of district, where the regional transport officer is part of the incident response team. Where required, this decontamination will take place in case of chemical hazards. Relief camps will have to establish in case of earthquakes and cyclones. Buildings are shaking. People are scared to go back to their houses. They'll have to be there. And once situation under control, the demobilization will take place, and the same resource will be deployed at some other place. Reallocation resource will take place, and relief activities will start. And once the cycle is complete, it may be ongoing for 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, 5 days. You saw Nepal, you saw Kerala, you saw Chennai. It's dynamic and ongoing. So again, the review of situation will take place. In next 24 hours, the plans will be made. Additional resources which have come, the army may come in, the NDRF may come in, even foreign aid may come in sometimes. And all that has been deployed again based upon a plan and a systematic manner. And this is what I want to briefly convey to you. And then we submit a final report just to see where are the gaps. Lessons learned are celebrated, all concerned for further improvement. Videography is done, CDs are made, and we do proper documentation, ensure that it is optimized by everyone. The reports are available to anyone who wants to learn from the experience. This already touched by Professor Jain, but at the local level, you are the most aware people. The teacher community most aware people. So research, development, teaching is one part, the higher end of the spectrum. But at the lower end, you have NCC, NSS, volunteers whom some of you may be leading because of being the associated NCC officers or even otherwise. And you have to be part of the process as responsible citizen at local level. You must ask for the plans, ask for your school safety plan, ask for what help will come to your school or college from outside if required. If you're next to a vulnerable, your college or school is next to an industrial unit, you ask for their plan. If your gas leaks, what will happen to your children? So all this, just trying to hint at you, because I, as mentioned to you, we're talking to a very, very enlightened lot. And psychosocial support is one major thing which can be done by basically all elderly wise people, which is happening in our villages, which is happening in our families. But in a structured way, this is required. And this is one of the weakest links. No one has got time to go to the families, talk to them, make sure that they are comfortable in face of the crisis. So this is where I thought I'll finish. I broadly told you how the response in particular takes place and what we're doing to improve our response. If there are any questions, I'll be very glad to answer.
Thank you very much, sir. The aim of National Disaster Management Authority is to build a safer India by developing a holistic, proactive, multi-disaster and technology-driven strategy. This has to be achieved through a culture of prevention, mitigation, and preparedness to generate a prompt and efficient response at the time of disasters. This National Vision's Inter Alia aims at inculcating a culture of preparedness among all the stakeholders. Thank you very much, sir. And there is a question for you, sir. Women self-help group can play main role. Are NDMA giving any training to them, or is there any future for such kind of initiative?
The NDMA, the women's self-help groups, while we talk of disaster response and talk of the organization at the national, at the district level, we have been insisting that all resources, maybe NCC, maybe students, maybe community, they have to be known, and they have to be, their capabilities are to be known to the district authorities, and they should be called in for appropriate response. Like a group of women volunteers can be very well used when there is a relief camp going on, when there are gender issues, when we have ladies and children basically kept their place. So what we are trying to say, that we already encouraging all the women self-help groups, we are encouraging NGOs who are gender centric, helping women in surviving disasters and coping with disasters. So all that approach is going on in NDMA, and we are insisting that they are available and they are known to this administration as to what they can do and what they cannot do. So they employ power.
Thank you very much, sir. For last presentation, we have with us Sri P.P. Srivastava, IAS retired. He is a member of Advisory Committee of National Disaster Management Authority and former member of Northeastern Council. Education, Urban Affairs, People, Participation, Governance, and Disaster Mitigation and Management remained areas of special interest for him. He gained knowledge and experience of handling natural disaster like earthquake, landslide, floods, and cyclone with local resources and traditional wisdom and coping practices. I pass on stage to you, sir.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. And I'm very grateful to General Nayak, our Professor Jain, and Professor Rana, for their excellent and deep views on this subject. They have described practically all aspects of the subject eloquence. And of course, we are grateful to General Bindal, Dr. Professor Prakash, for having this program to reach the most important community in the country, that is the academic community. And it has been planned brilliantly by Dr. Harjeet Kaur, Anil Kathayat, and all their colleagues. See, the makers of the future are the academic community members. What I'm going to describe is not, I'm not going to repeat all the excellent things which have been already dealt with such good, in such a brilliant manner by all my producing speakers. I will now concentrate on the understanding, on the need for understanding of this subject by the common man, by the community, by the first responders who lose their lives if they don't understand it properly, and lose their lives if they don't know what to do in it. You see, unfortunately, even 70 years after independence, we behave like as if we are not, we are mere sub, we continue to remain subjects of some foreign ruler, ruled, who has invaded our mental faculties also. And we have started thinking not like a native Indian, but as a foreigner. And so the attitude that acha sarkar karegi if the disaster management sarkar ka kaam hai, sarkar jo karegi karegi, we are thinking a government is something apart from us. The main thing, if we want to save our lives in natural disasters, is that the first responders should really respond first of all, instead of waiting for help to come from somewhere else. You know, we have got, as far as governmental machinery is concerned, we have got one of the best organizations, ND, and disaster management organizations in the world. we have got a very good act. We have got all very dedicated workers. Now here General Nayak has described how our brilliant army, which saves our countries, save our citizens from external aggression, is also saving us so much from natural disaster. There it's totally involved. We have got a brilliant NDRF, the force which has won such recognition from the local people, of which I am myself eyewitness in the northeastern region. You see, it was about, I think, 2011, 12 or 13. In that year, I was going through a village. Assam had suffered from very serious floods, where even animals had been submerged for days and were getting sick. We went through a village, and then an end also started coming there. The villagers mobbed them literally, stopped their jeep and said, "No, no, 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 you have saved my life." And they showed his wife, "You see, this lady was stranded somewhere, you have saved it. How can we let you go? Please have a cup of tea. It's a great honor for us." You know, that's such sort of, identity is being shown by the common villager deep in the Assam Valley to such people. So this is the spirit what we need. We want every citizen to become almost like NDRF in so far as response is concerned. It is not impossible. The people, yes, sorry. Sorry, I thought it was from NDIM. So what we need is that we should emulate in this way the people of Japan, the Japanese people. You see, there every adult man, woman, and child, they know, as soon as this warning is sounded, they know exactly what to do, where to go, whom to contact. They don't have to think. It comes to them as a reflex action. Now that should be our project. We have this thing because natural disasters, the factors that cause natural disasters are not alien to us. We are made, our own body and mind are made of the same elements which cause in our system, culture and traditional, we call them the panchatattva. That is the Akash, sky, Agni, energy, Vayu, the gaseous state of nature, the Jal, the liquid state of nature, and three, the Earth, the solid state, Prithvi, the solid state of nature. We are also made of the same thing. And so if we tune into our everything, we can also get some signal about it. And we can be more efficient in saving our lives. And another thing, saving of life, own and others, is the act of highest merit in our tradition. Why do we, the common man, say, "Acha, sarkar karegi to theek hai, sarkar batayegi wo karenge." We should know what to do. It should come to us intuitively. Now that is the main thing which has to be developed by us, and how we can do it. Okay, but let me come to some of the natural disasters and why India is in a greatest advantageous position. You see, India, our whole history is shaped by geography, by natural factors. We are lucky in having the highest mountain in our north. Is all on three sides of us. We have, we have got all types of climatic conditions which exist in the world in our country. We have got luscious forests. We have got, burning deserts also in Rajasthan, in the Thar desert. And in between all sides of things, we have got the Western Ghats, the Aravallis, all types of climates are there. We have got another thing. And that is why, because of this, whatever exists anywhere else in the universe does exist in our country also. And that is why our culture, our thinking is universal, has got that universality. It is all inclusive. It does not exclude anything. Disaster management is also something which we are intuitively aware, only we are not bothered about it. What are these things of which we are so much afraid of? You see, the science, we have to be grateful to science also for having revealed so many things. Science has told us that we are situated on one of the three active seismic belts. It is the Alpine Himalayan seismic belt, and it extends starts from Southeast Asia near Java, Sumatra, continues through Andaman and Nicobar Islands and Indo-Burma border regions, and it swings through the north of India in the foothills of Himalayan, and then moves west through Iran into Greece and Italy. Now, this is the, we are already there, and therefore we should, and we are tuned to it, not that nature has left it like that. We are tuned to this thing. And I'll tell you gradually how. Now let us see earthquake. I'm not going to the, you all know it, how earthquakes occurs and what it them. The main thing about earthquake is that earthquakes do not kill directly. It is the, they trigger some activities which kill. And most of these are man-made. So if we take precautions right from the beginning and construct buildings or structures which are resilient to the maximum earthquake which is anticipated, and maximum magnitude of earthquake anticipated, nothing will happen to us. We'll forget it. We know that Jalatat water, so it flows, it must go downward, it must have some channel. Lock that channel. This thing, flooding occurred. And so, this is the situation in a city. If somebody is constructing a building, if the authorities go, if at all they go, to stop it, if it is on fire and a danger to that, the owner will be able to mobilize support in his favor. What about the public opinion? Public opinion, especially of the youth, the students, the learners, they should come and say, look here, this is endangered, the whole thing, let it happen. So instead of helping the authorities, they are stopped from doing this. This is a normal experience. And this happens because of our ignorance. And how will that ignorance go? It is through our academic community. They have to shape the children, minds of the children, acquaint them with the realities, with the of being in tune with nature, to understand nature and how it behaves, and then to protect themselves from its effects. So that is how this particular series of webinars designed by India, NIDM, are absolutely admirable and laudable. Now let us come to the carelessness costs in this. You might be knowing the example of Haiti and Chile. Similar type of similar magnitude of earthquake struck these two places within a matter of within a month or 2 months interval, but the damage in Haiti was they said 3 lakhs or something, but ultimately it came to 92,000 deaths. In Chile, with a slightly higher magnitude earthquake, within about a month or so, the actual death toll was just 486 actually identified, though say some said 802. 92,000 in one case, 800 or 400-500 in one case. Why? Only thing is because all the planning regulations and building bylaws had been followed in Chile and not in Haiti. Haiti was just like many places where everybody does exactly what he feels like doing. Without, but then how will the consciousness come? Similarly, is with floods and another new thing, landslide is also a phenomenon for which our scientists have already perfected the solution. They say they are predictable, preventable, and controllable. And this has been said, and I mean, by experts, Indian experts, all the disciplines concerned with this, relevant to this thing. And they have said that. And now it has been, this was done in 2005. I was also a part of that. You know, it was done by Indian National Academy of Engineers, the highest engineering body of the country. And it is now with the NDMA. We are waiting for its application of this formula which they have to some of the major nagging landslides of the country. And the solution is very common. If a person falls ill and the illness you see concerns many organs, a few specialists, those things have to be consulted, not the general physician. The aspirin formula will not help. You need experts. Exactly the same thing is required in landslides. Just an engineer. Now today what happens is a landslide is there, communication is disrupted. The PWD, local PWD, its own whole future and reputation depends on how soon it can just restore the communication. No matter, next year in the same season, the same thing will again recur and it will keep on recurring for years together, permanently. But that is the thing. Instead, what has been suggested by experts is that geotechnologists, geologists, soil experts and engineers all combined should exactly see what are the real causes, what is the extent of looseness of soil, is there any through it and ground, at what pressure or what moisture level the thing disintegrates, I mean it landslide occurs, and they have to be prevented and they have to be controlled, and which can be done in 99.9% cases. And if that is done, the whole thing will be yes. And then second thing, our main job, main idea is to save lives and save assets from natural disasters. So there is one thing called early warning system. At least life should be saved. If the assets cannot be saved, life should be saved. That early warning system is available in case of earthquakes, in case of landslides, in case of floods. We have tackled in Assam, in Northeast, we have tackled the problem of early warning in case of floods. Early warning means the people are told up to about 48 hours in advance, 48 hours in advance, the extent of inundation to be, which is likely to be anticipated. And this is done by, the exercise has been done by the Northeastern Space Application Center, which is conducting this thing. So that these things are available and they have actually saved lives there. Similarly, lightning is another now new thing has come up, and that too also, if we know anybody, even uneducated, illiterate person can use his traditional wisdom to see the signs and then escape from it. It's not difficult. That knowledge should be there and that should come from within. So the main thing is that it is the community, the common man should really become the most active agent in the entire disaster management authority. And they should save themselves with the help of the government agencies, NDMA and DMAs and NDRF, and not the other way around, that only if a disaster occurs, they must first come and they must save. So the whole attitude has to change. That is the main thing, important thing, which has to be taken into account. That means the community has to be mobilized. Now the problem is how to mobilize the community, because that stage where the normal citizen realizes his responsibility and feels that it is his government, he has set up this government, and there should be that communion. I help, I should take the initiative, government will come and help. Government shall come help. That attitude should be there. Instead of the attitude, theek hai bhai, government batayega to hum karega. That is not the right thing to do. Now this, and the people should themselves be sensitive to the early warning systems. Now let us take the example of earthquake. I have been lucky to know one scientist. His name is Dr. Arun Bapat. He has done a lot of work in early warning system, which can be known by the citizens. I have been, you see, in the Northeast, and I have undertaken I have walked through the hills and mountains, all the interdependent border, because in 1960 was the first when I went there posted, and in 62 I have faced in my frontier division to Kameng was occupied by the Chinese for some time in 62, and mine was the adjacent decision where they intruded in some areas, although they did not stay very long there. So I have seen those things, Longzhou and Taoxing and Limeking, all these places. So these, what happens, say, how does the traditional wisdom help them? You see, when we used to go and start camping in a nice place to camp for the night, dig our, make a small hut to spend the night there. The elder village, the Ram Buddhas, they will come and say, no, sir, don't avoid this spot. If a strong gust of wind will come and then this thing will go. They had that traditional wisdom. And they knew by instinct which places are safe and which are not. I have yet to get a report from villagers of the old tribal, of old traditional tribal villages having been affected by earthquakes or landslides. The old thing. New tribal villages who are now getting away from nature, or new non-tribal, all these people, government buildings, etc., they are very much vulnerable. But not one traditional tribal village. In 1897, a big, huge earthquake, Shillong earthquake. It was followed in 1950 by another earthquake just beyond our borders. But only rocks fell. River, Lohit River was obstructed, that broke its banks, and the flood water destroyed towns like Sadia and also affected the Dibrugarh, damaged something. But not one traditional old village was affected. But we are now forgetting that traditional wisdom, but those signs are there. We can revive that. For example, you see, we have built up, from this Northeastern Regional Institute of Science and Technology, with which I was associated for a long time. We have built a series of seismographs underground stations in the Northeastern area, and where we could see, study the entire earthquake process and see them sitting in our laboratory at Durham. And we used to get information from, say, Manipur border, from the villages next day, that array, the villagers said, oh, no, 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 all sorts of ants have come out, and the insects have come out, and frogs are jumping out of the village. A flood is going to come, an earthquake is coming. And they could take precautions. So these precursors are very much available. Only thing is, we don't bother about them. We have no knowledge about them. We don't think about them. You know, one very interesting thing. Dr. Bapat has studied all these Latur earthquake and all those big earthquakes, Bhuj earthquake, everything. They have studied and found that in our own society, of course, animals, everybody knows that animals get early warning of earthquakes. And if we study them, or if we notice that, and we have a system of reporting, we can give an early warning of earthquake. Dangerous earthquake, 7 and above. But one very, even man gets it, you know, especially the ladies are very sensitive.
I regret for this inconvenience to all the participants. Meanwhile, we just talk about that sir is talking about the traditional knowledge and how we use this traditional knowledge in our disaster management. So we know that the traditional knowledge holds the elements of those ancient stories, myths and which according to the modern scientific world, modern scientific view does not have any rational explanation, because the scientific knowledge does not believe in subjective reality. Measurement, experimentation and verification are one of the prime steps of scientific modern knowledge. However, modern scientific society forgets that those ancient stories and folklores have been developed through centuries-old experiences with the natural environment. Despite advancement in knowledge and technology today, such as satellite coverage and surveillance techniques, vulnerability to risk from natural hazard have been increasing in developing and developed countries. I want to share one example that in 1995, Kobe earthquake in Japan killed more than 6,000 people. In 2005, Hurricane Katrina in the United States killed about more than 1,800 people. And in 2011, Tohoku earthquake in Japan killed 50,000 people. And in 2017, Hurricane Harvey in the United States killed 88 people. So this raised the question about the capability and sustainability of the so-called modern civilization and their advanced technology in reducing disaster risk in future. Are we moving towards the brighter side of human civilization, or are we still not conscious about what we must do? So, Anil sir?
You can conclude.
Then it's my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on record. I wish to express my sincere gratitude to Professor Vinod Kumar Jain, Vice Chancellor, Tejpur University, and Professor H.S. Yadav, Director, Northeastern Regional Institute of Science and Technology, for sparing his precious time from his busy schedule for providing engagement and support to all of us. I express my gratitude to Major General Manoj Kumar Bindal, ED NIDM, for providing innovative and encouraging environment, moral guidance, continuous enthusiasm, and valuable suggestions throughout NIDM endeavor. Mention our deep sense of appreciation for Sri Priti Srivastava, IAS retired member, NDMA Advisory Board, Major General Dr. V.K. Nayak, Senior Consultant, NDMA, and Sri R.K. Rana, Inspector General, NDRF, for their presence to enlighten the participants with their vast knowledge and experiences. I hope all the participants will have some takeaways point from this program. And with this, we have come to end of the today's program. And I request all of you, Dr. Sarkar, to join us tomorrow using the same link, and the assignment will be sent to you via email. Thank you. Thank you very much. Be with us.